That's why she can't have nice things.
Either that or I steal them.
Hmm?
What?
What's that?
Hmm? What? What do you want, Pam? Because I'm a little busy for chit-chat.
Busy trying to turn that thing on?
Look at this.
O-N.
Nothing.
Well, just keep at it.
You're not my supervisor.
Hey, everyone. It's Mark Sargent, and this is Flat Earth Q&A emails. I believe this is 18. And we're going to do something a little bit different because, as you know, in the description of my videos, at the bottom, you see something that says Secretary's Desk. A lot of people don't know what that means. But I do mention from time to time in Strange World episodes that my secretary has carelessly left the mailbag full of letters on my desk. I never know where she is most of the time. Half the time, I think she's down at the bar. The other half the time, I think she's asleep under her desk. Either way, she always leaves early and she always leaves mail on the desk. So this time, I grabbed her and I said, look, I need some help. Would you mind reading some of the email questions to me so I can do a little back and forth? And she said, well, you're not my supervisor. And I said, well, actually, in this case, I am. So with that, I'd like to introduce my administrative assistant, most of the time incorrigible and some of the time insubordinate. How are you?
Well, hello. Thank you for the positive reviews. I have been working diligently and hard. So, you know, but I may or may not have stopped the bar along my way to here. So, would you like to kick this off with the first email? Mark?
I would at that.
All right, I'll give you an easy one to start.
Okay.
Ready?
Go.
Okay, subject to be read and answered on radio. I guess this isn't really radio, YouTube, but whatever.
Whatever.
Anyways,
no.
What are your three biggest problems with ISS footage?
My three biggest problems with ISS footage. First one would be, you can look this up, ISS hairspray. That's the biggest one, where women or people with long hair, and in this case it's all women, why they allow long hair in the ISS at all, I have no idea. The hair should be trimmed extremely short, if not shaved entirely. They should all be wearing hats, or their hair should be pulled back. And what they did was to make sure that people knew there was something funny going on with gravity, they put hairspray in their hair. They permed it to where all the women look like Bride of Frankenstein. The hair does not move naturally. It stays straight up. It snaps back. It should be flowing. If it's true zero G, it should be flowing very naturally, like you would in a pool, like you would in water. And they're doing this for two reasons. One, they want to show that something's weird going on with gravity, which means you could be using the Vomit Comet plane to simulate it. The other would be that you don't want to show any gravity shift in the ISS, because the ISS should be moving very, very smoothly. Nothing should be bumping at all, like a jet airplane when you're doing a parabolic curve, generating zero Gs. And they don't want to show that, so they say, okay, well, we're going to make sure their hair doesn't move at all, and then everyone holds onto the handrails and keeps as still as they can. That's the first part. The second part would be hatches, which is like a submarine. There should be hatches between compartments. No one seems to care about the fact that a micrometeor the size of a nickel should be able to punch through that hole, and everyone would die because all the hatches are wide open. On top of that, where are the hatches? Why didn't you ever see anybody open or closing a door other than leaving the space station? Of course, that leads into a whole other thing, which is, why have we never seen an astronaut in an airlock and the door open and then they leave with it? Why do we never ever see that? The third thing would be the lack of concern, not just for hygiene, but for water in general. And I'm not talking just about sponge baths. I'm talking about, sweat and tears and blood and everything else. Fluids and electronics do not mix. And when you watch the videos of them floating around that place, especially the woman who was like washing her hair, there's water droplets flying everywhere. And there's electrical panels within 2 feet of her head. And you're going, why? She has no concern that the water's going to get on these panels, not to mention just flying everywhere else. That place would be so unbelievably gross. They should be cleaning it all the time. They should be doing maintenance all the time. Sorry, those are my top three things, but I could go on forever and ever. about the ISS. Lots of other people on YouTube have done some wonderful videos on the ISS. Just look up Flat Earth ISS or ISS Fake and you'll find a ton of things. Next, please.
Yeah, no doubt. Okay, next one. Hi, Mark. Having now seen more than enough Flat Earth videos to understand the whole rationale, I wanted to contact you since your presentations are the most convincing. But I did a little thought experiment this morning and I believe it settles the whole matter. Please read the below and let me know your thoughts. What is the horizon? It is that clear dividing line between land and sky. Standing on the shore, looking out at sea, that line is about 3 miles away. On a clear day, the line is sharp. It is 3 miles away because, after that distance, the curve of the earth takes over and you cannot see beyond it. The horizon is there because the surface is curved. If it were flat, there would be no horizon! Exclamation mark. On a clear day, instead of a sharp line between sea and sky, you would simply see the sea going on forever into the distance, way beyond 3 miles. It would simply gradually blend with the sky as it recedes mile after mile into the distance, even on the clearest of days. Is that what we see? This is all proof, all the proof I need that the surface of the earth is curved. It doesn't prove it's a globe, of course. It just proves that it is not flat. Thank you, John.
Yeah, John's got an interesting point there, but I had to deal with this right off the bat, which is when you're looking out in the distance, you got to remember there's multiple factors that don't allow you to see very far. Not unlike looking underwater. When you've seen the underwater films, even if you see a whale at a couple hundred yards, they disappear very, very quickly. And that is because even the clearest water gets murky because it's water. Same thing with atmosphere. You think you're breathing oxygen, just oxygen, but it's actually a combination of oxygen and nitrogen. As a matter of fact, 4 parts nitrogen to 1 part oxygen. You gotta wonder if a nitrogen-based life form actually came to Earth, how well they would do. But so if you took away those things, like the soup that is our atmosphere, if it was a vacuum, you would be able to see much, much further because it is flat. You look, there's so many other videos I could point you to, but you've got to wonder why when a boat goes off into the distance, you know, past that 3 miles, the human visual range, and then you take a high magnification camera, why can you now bring that boat back into focus? You know, at 10 miles, at 20 miles, that shouldn't be possible. There's so many different examples I could use. Why can you see the Statue of Liberty from 60 miles away from a boat? You shouldn't be able to, because the curvature of the earth, if it's 8 inches per mile squared, is 60 miles times 60 times 60 times 8. That's a long way. That's way higher than the Statue of Liberty. So all these things factor in. I know what you want to see there, but you're trying to, and I appreciate the thought experiment, but unless it's a vacuum, you're not going to be able to see very far anyway. The distortion of our atmosphere creates a whole bunch of different effects. Look up the fun video I recommend. It's not very long by comparison to others, and Jaron did a great job. Look up the YouTube channel Jaronism, Jaranism, and just type in Flat Earth Boat. And you will see a wonderful video he put together which shows some great optical effects that take place over the water. Next email, please.
Cool. Yeah, that video from Jaronism was awesome. I agree.
Yep.
Next one from Nathaniel. I watched your video on YouTube when I was looking for scientific evidence of God. I'm a reasonable and logical person who has felt and seen the miracles with my own eyes. Now I find your theory about a flat earth, and I cannot help but believe it all. This is a new idea to me, but I am sold. Not sure how to feel or what to do, but you said feel free to contact. I only heard this idea 2 days ago for the first time after I watched your videos 2 times. As I said, not sure what all this means. Advice?
Well, when it comes to Flat Earth and spirituality, there's a reason why by the time I got to the end of the Flat Earth Clues, I was titling them Souls in the System and They Are Hiding God. And there's a reason why, you know, one of the big YouTube presentations of My Flat Earth Clues is called They Are Hiding God with the Greatest Lie Ever. Because we are talking about the fundamental principles of science versus religion. And I hate to boil it down to that, you know, because I do believe in a separation of church and state to a point. But everyone seems to protect their own interests. And by that, I'll use the Raiders of the Lost Ark reference, which is, we all know the Ark of the Covenant, Raiders of the Lost Ark, that fun early 80s movie with Indiana Jones. The Americans got the Ark in the end. What did they do to it? They took it to a warehouse in Area 51, and they put it in there, and they locked it away forever and ever. Because Ark of the Covenant, and it doesn't really matter what it is, the Ark of the Covenant, the Holy Grail, a magic wand, the Ring of Power from Lord of the Rings, the Spear of Destiny, goes on and on, Solomon's Signet. All these things defy science. I should have put it on a t-shirt a long time ago, and that is, science is just magic without mystery. That's all it is. You know, things that we describe, you know, 100, 200 years ago, which would be magic to some people, if you can repeat it enough, it becomes commonplace, and then the mystery is gone. The whole point of magic is that there's a mystery behind it. There's this unknown, the secret, and human beings do love a mystery, and that's what we're driven to. That's what we crave. And so that's why you can't see the Ark of the Covenant or the Holy Grail or any of these other things, because science doesn't like question marks. They do not like question marks. The same reason why, even though they don't know if you believe in the sphere, we've never dug past 8 miles, why you never see a science book with a big question mark in the center of the world, because science doesn't like unanswered questions. So they're just going to create theories, and eventually those theories are going to be accepted as fact. When you build up a theory for the last 500 years and say it's a globe, the last thing you want to do is tell people that, oh yeah, by the way, it wasn't a globe. It turns out it was an enclosed system, because an enclosed system is much, much different from a globe. An enclosed system screams some sort of higher power. And that means either, you know, an advanced civilization or God, or a one step closer to God. I'm not saying it's the handprint of God, but it's pretty close. Or it's a lot closer than we've ever been before, and it completely undermines science. So does that help spirituality? Yes, it does. Every religion will get a boost from this. Science will take a big gut punch from this. If you're going to look into this from a spirituality standpoint, definitely look into Rob Skiba's testingtheglobe.com, and Zen Garcia's written some great books. Look at the Book of Enoch, the Book of Jasher. There's some wonderful, there's a lot of religious references to this. I'll use one more thing, and that is, Wernher von Braun, the father of rocket science, the ex-Nazi scientist who formed NASA. He, on his headstone, very modest, is, you know, the year he was born, the year he died, and then Psalm 19:1. Just says Psalm 19:1. I had to look it up myself. And it says, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Why is the father of rocket science talking about a domed structure where we live? Next question, please.
Excellent. Okay. The next one, the subject is curvature. Mark, I'm a geocentrist who had his eyes opened March of 2016. I cut my teeth on your clues and Eric Dubé's videos. Listening to your interviews, on more than one occasion, you say curvature is most evident looking forward and much less so to your left and right. I don't agree. Standing on a globe, the curvature is the same no matter what direction you look. Should it be prevalent and consistent as I look over my right shoulder and then over my left shoulder? Why do you explain curvature as being most evident when looking forward and not as obvious to the left or right? Thanks, Norm.
Good question, Norm. And I don't actually get that one very often, but I have gotten it a few times. And the easiest way to explain it is, objects don't disappear when you're looking to the left and the right. It is much less prevalent. It's tougher to figure out what's happening from your left and right. But even mainstream science, Neil deGrasse Tyson's come on television and said, you can't get up high enough to see the curvature when you're going side to side, left to right. But forward and back, objects should be able to disappear, because then you're looking over the front of the most exaggerated form of the hill, if you believe in the curvature. So you're looking, you're looking directly into the 8 inches per mile squared, and objects will disappear, like a lighthouse, like a building, like a shoreline, like a boat. You can't see that side to side, or it's way tougher to. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen a video that shows anything along those lines. So, and again, the challenge I still put out there, which is 18, 20 months old now, which is if you think you see the curvature side to side, and some people said, oh, I see it from the beach, I see it from a plane, take a picture of it and send it to me. If I get it and I see the same thing you're doing and it's not a fisheye lens, heck, I'll quit Flat Earth right now. But it's been 18, 20 months and no one's done that to me. So there you go. Thank you for the question, Norm.
Cool. Totally agree. I've taken some flights since I've bought into the flat earth theory or awakening. And, you know, sometimes I can trick my mind into seeing there's a curve, but ultimately it really isn't there. So I totally get what you're saying. It's a funny trick of the mind.
Yeah. Yeah. We want to believe it. It's conditioning that we've had for a long, long time. The Captain Picard, Star Trek Next Generation, where he's captured by the Cardassians and they torture him and they try to tell him he's shown four lights and they tell them there's five, I believe. I think it's five. And by the end, he was actually believing that there were five lights, even though he was resistant all the way to the end. It wouldn't give up anything. The basic subtext conditioning was working on him. And imagine doing that. And that was just a short torture, week or several weeks or a month or whatever it was. Imagine being shown a globe for 12 years, every day for 12 years. You are, that's just your schooling. That's not, not television stuff or any space programs or any other conditioning you're watching when you get home. It is the most effective brainwashing of all time. So I know people want to see the curve, but you can't show it to me. The easiest way to show it to people is forward and back, not left and right.
Okay. On to the next one. This one is from Andreas, and this is questions about the Flat Earth theory. Mm-hmm. Dear Mark, I just stumbled over this theory 3 weeks ago when a friend told me about it. As I would describe me as an open-minded person who doesn't necessarily believe that 9/11 was an act of terrorists, I am just watching your YouTube video and I would like to ask two questions before I continue watching, as they came up pretty fast. In the video, you say that they found the edge of in the Antarctica. What about the other edges? If the Earth is a flat disk, there must be more edges. Where are they? I just learned further in the video that the edge is a complete ring of ice. So maybe my second question will also be answered in the video. Second question that bothers me about the theory is, how do seasons work on a flat Earth? On a ball version of the Earth, it's taught in school. It seems pretty reasonable to me. Best regards from Zurich, Switzerland, Andreas.
Okay, and he did answer one of his questions right away, which was Antarctica is not what you think it is. And for those of you who are new to the whole Flat Earth concept and are just picking up on this one, you probably shouldn't be listening to a Q&A video. You should probably go into YouTube and just type in Flat Earth and watching the first 10 videos. However, if you've come this far, I might as well explain a little bit of it to you, which is Antarctica is not an island continent, which is similar to Australia, where you can go around it. Because if it is a flat world, meaning it's not like a basketball, it's like a dinner plate, then there's got to be an edge. And what is that edge? Well, it's got to be the bottom, which is Antarctica. And Antarctica would be spread out like a giant ice wall, for lack of a better term. And Antarctica as a continent is very, very unusual in that regards. It's 200 feet of ice straight up off the coastline, which is why, the water doesn't fall off the edge. And then it slopes up to about 14,000 feet, plateaus of 14,000 feet for most of it, and then goes up, even higher than 20,000 feet in some cases. It is very, very unique. It is almost like the edge of a bathtub in some regards, only it's frozen. So that would be the edge. As far as how the seasons go, if the sun and the moon are traveling above this like balls, like a mobile above a child's crib, then they're also not going to take the same path every time. All you have to do is alter the path, kind of like a needle on a record. A needle, as you know, moves in and you can move it out. So it doesn't. It takes a slightly different path every time it goes around. Rob Skiba's got a wonderful graphic that shows how the sun kind of slightly changes. Plus, you could also change the intensity of the sun if you wanted. Depending, there's all sorts of fun things you could do. But seasons not hard to do with a flat Earth model at all. Thank you very much, Switzerland.
All right, next email. Subject, I'm sure you already blah, 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 dot, dot, dot.
Okay.
And it goes, what up, stud? I am watching Operation Avalanche. I would bet half of my savings that the film studio hired you as a consultant. How's life, Mark? I hope all is well with you and have a happy flat new year. Francis.
Well, thank you, Francis. And what up indeed? That's me being super white and not street. I had nothing to do with Operation Avalanche. And I know you pronounce it Avalanche, but I think that's because you are from Canada originally. Everything in Hollywood is done in pairs, and that is asteroid movies and volcano movies and just about any action movie, you're going to find, more than one studio is a race to get it done. And they figure, they think they can make a slightly better version. Ron Perlman, the actor who was known for mostly for Hellboy, a great series, he did a movie just last year, I believe, that touched on this or could have been the end of 2015. I think it was 2016, though. I can't remember. Where they were talking about faking the moon landing and looking, he was a CIA operative that was looking for Stanley Kubrick because they wanted to fake some footage for the moon landing just in case the actual moon landing didn't make it. And Operation Avalanche, I think, was going along those same lines where they weren't sure if they could do it, and so they were going to come up with some fake footage. And I have not seen it. I had nothing to do with that movie. But I do pride myself on some creative writing. I think I'm a fairly good writer when it comes to this stuff, and I have the ability to bend my mind and open myself up to new concepts, which is why the flat Earth, once I latched onto it, it became very easy. It wasn't a conflict with my brain to where I was constantly regretting the decisions I was making here. So thank you for that. And other than that, life's good. I'm going to be in Victoria next week and going to be doing, I think, a Flat Earth Mixer, hopefully in Seattle in April. We'll see. But I'm also doing a speaking engagement, doing a whole bunch of more interviews and keeping myself very, very busy. And I'm kind of curious who the 100th interview is going to be. I've got a few more lined up, but I don't have the 100th one lined up yet. So thank you, Francis.
Cool. I like it. So your next question. Good morning. It's amazing about the video you have been posting. People think I'm crazy when I tell them stories about visions or dreams, maybe real life, and I am having in a supposedly dream. How come they haven't shut you down having these types of theories? I have an open-minded mind for everything. I do believe other beings exist. I've seen them in my dreams. What have you seen? It's not normal for us to wonder about things knowing that we have chemicals and stuff that restrict us from knowing more. I know someone, but it was stories that a friend tells me about him. He has seen things and knows much also. I would like to learn more, if that is possible. Where can I start to do research and stuff? It's hard to even start with so many lies told. Hope I hear from you. Thank you. Chianti.
Well, Chianti, a couple things. First would be they haven't shut me down, I believe, because I think they wanted to get out. Remember that so many of the people that have gotten into the Flat Earth community have done so because they were recommended by YouTube. When you go into YouTube, especially if you have a YouTube account, you see recommended for you on the right-hand side. If you want to shut this thing down, it's easy enough. Just make sure that no one ever gets a flat earth video recommended to them. Or when you go into any search engine, when you type in the earth is, or is the, it shouldn't come up the earth is flat. Right now, we have the top search criteria result, which is, you know, you type in is the earth, it will always say flat now at the top of the screen. Well, why is that? You wouldn't do that unless you're letting it out. It's being let out deliberately. Does that sound like a movie plot? Yes, it does, where the hero is walking into a trap. He knows it's a trap, but he's got to go into it anyway because the plot has to move forward. And that's how what I feel is happening here. Nobody's come to me. No one's approached me and said that, you know, you have to stop doing this. No one's tried to threaten me or bribe me. I told, of course, you know, I've said on air that I'm never going to take the money. And I firmly will hold to that, nor, you know, can you really threaten me with anything. But so why not just, you know, off me? Why not off anybody in the Flat Earth community to send a message? That hasn't been done either. So it's very, very curious. I think it's part of a bigger picture here. When it comes to my dreams, awfully personal, but I will say that often I dream about the world that's outside of here, which is the unlimited universe. I believe that this is not a static universe by any stretch. I think that we are in a world of conflict, and I think it's conflict, inescapable conflict at all levels. And I think it's deliberate. I think it's part amusement park ride, part terrarium, part planetarium, and that we are here voluntarily as part of an education system, as part to gain perspective. And as far as learning more, I will try to send you a list. People that are new to this, I usually try to send them to a playlist that I created called the Flat Earth Short List for new people. And there's about 20 videos in there, some ranging as little as 5 minutes, others that are a couple hours long. That should get you started. So thank you, Shianti.
Excellent. Dreams, how they might tie into, you know, our flat world.
I mean, are dreams the, you know, are they just random electrical impulses, or are they, I don't think so. I think they are part of something much, much bigger, and it's hard for us to process them because we have extra senses outside of this place. And with our limited 5 senses that we have here, we have a hard time. Plus, people keep forgetting that time is infinitely relative, but that's a whole other topic for another time. Next email.
Okay, next one. So, I heard you on the Mysterious Radio podcast and found the whole Flat Earth theory to be incredibly intriguing. And listening to you discuss it all was very entertaining to boot. But I have one question for you. Why the paid site? Seeing the paid site makes me instantly want to rethink my entire opinion of you and your theory, because now suddenly it looks like simply a scam for cash. I don't want to think this, so please give me a reason not to. Thanks, Andrew.
Why? I never. Well, that's not exactly true. I'm just trying to come up with some sort of outrage statement, but I don't think I can have one. No, I'm going to let myself off the hook here because none of this was my doing. As a matter of fact, every single thing I've done in the Flat Earth world to date has been unsolicited. You got to remember that I didn't even monetize my YouTube channel for the first 15 months. And that wasn't, I just turned it on, you know, not so long ago. And that was because I wanted to get the message out there. And then finally, YouTube themselves, forget about all the other little sub companies inside YouTube that try to solicit you. YouTube contacted me directly and said, are you sure you don't want to monetize? I thought that was really weird. And I said, all right, fine, I'll monetize. But when it comes to everything else, I haven't solicited anybody. So all the interviews that I've gotten, the 90 plus interviews that I've done, they've all contacted me directly. I haven't, not like I did bulk emails out to every podcast and station that was out there. They all hear from other people. A perfect example would be the Ground Zero interview that I did. I did Ground Zero with Clyde. He, you know, Coast to Coast monitors what Ground Zero is doing. They called me. And then through Coast to Coast, the book publishing company out of London called me and said, oh, yeah, I heard you on Coast to Coast. How would you like to do a book? Okay. And then because of that, then the apps came out. And then the website, finally, MarkSargent.com, which was done by the same guy that did the apps. And we initially did the apps for free. And they said, yeah, maybe we should, you know, people are willing to pay for it. Okay, sure. Why not? So what did I care? I mean, it's kind of a ride for me. Do I have some bills to pay? Yes. You know, money's always good, but that's not the driving force for me in this. It is to get the word out. I really do want to change the world. I want to see the 100th monkey effect. I want to see a new golden age. Money is great, but how satisfying is money if the world is screwed up? I know there's people sitting on millions of dollars saying, well, you know, when you're on a jet ski, how can you be depressed? If you rode the jet ski long enough, you could, but we're getting kind of weird philosophical topic now. So point is, none of this had to do with me. Everybody approached me with it, and, you know, including the TV people. The television show thing hasn't happened yet, but if a television station comes out tomorrow and says, yeah, we want to do a reality show on Flat Earth, okay, sure. Love to do it, as long as it sticks with Flat Earth. Now, if they said, oh, yeah, we want you to do something else instead. We want you to focus on Hollow Earth or the Mandela Effect or something else. I'd probably say, no, it's not my thing. Look at my videos. My track record, I think, speaks for itself, which is just about every single video I've done has Flat Earth in the title, no matter what. And I really try to stay on point. I pride myself on staying focused. And that's what I'm going to continue with. So hopefully that satisfies your criteria, Andrew.
Sounds good. I am personally a subscriber to MarkSargent.com, and I really enjoy the opinions of yours, Mark, that are not necessarily Flat Earth related. I think they're really interesting. You know, if you dig Mark Sargent, why not listen to his other opinions on other things?
Yeah, and eventually I'll, you know, depending on how it goes, who knows, maybe the stuff on MarkSargent.com will be released, you know, to the general public, because I do have a lot of opinions on a lot of things. I'm not just a one-trick pony, although I am kind of doing that right now. I'm definitely doing the same choreography all the time, which is Flat Earth, Flat Earth, Flat Earth, Flat Earth, because everything else to me is second tier. Anyway, next.
Where we go? Okay. Next is subject, truth seeker asking an honest question. Hello, Mark. I hope all is well. I have recently come across this Flat Earth idea. In 38 days, I've spent about 200 hours researching this topic, and I thought would be debunked in about 10 minutes. I have surprisingly little proof for the ball Earth. However, I have found one question that seems to present a reasonable line of inquiry for the Flat Earth model. I've contacted two prominent Flat Earth YouTubers with no response. On a spinning ball with an axis, or on a fixed ball with a rotating star canopy, I would expect to have two pole stars. With so many lights in the sky, I would expect two would randomly align with a ball Earth axis, thereby creating two fixed points of light. Whether the Earth or universe is rotating, that, to me, makes sense. I can and do observe Polaris, though I have not observed Sima Octantis. I'm only finding confirmation of its existence being an observably fixed point of light in the southern night sky. If this is true, it seems to pose a serious problem for the Flat Earth model. Here is my question. While on a flat Earth, I would also expect to have a North Star, a single fixed point of light above the center of a flat plane. However, if Sigma Octantis exists as a pole star, how can a fixed point of light be observed by three different continents on three opposing parts of a flat plane? That, to me, does not make sense. Where would you put a pole star in the night sky of a flat Earth model, allowing observations by South America, Africa, and Australia? This is not meant to be anything other than a serious and peaceful inquiry. I know this was long. Thank you for any time or effort you may have to answer. Kind regards, John.
Okay, John. And I'm going to be as delicate as I can here. You've got to be able to open your mind up. And by that, it sounds like you've never played any video games recently, at least over the last 15, 20 years, or any simulations, because that's what we've been doing in simulations pretty much for the last, you know, better part of 20 years. I'll use the, you know, my current favorite game, which is World of Warcraft, which I've been playing since vanilla, which is using instancing and technology that we have now. We're not talking about advanced technology that is way off in the future. We can do this on a smaller scale right now, at least in simulations. Could we apply this to a giant planetarium? Yes, we could. Absolutely. Am I saying we're doing this now? You know, no. There's an advanced civilization that's controlling this world. But we can do it on a much, much smaller scale. I'll give you an example. In a planetarium, if you use multiple display systems, I'm standing on one end, you, John, are on the other end. We're talking to each other on the phone, and you say, I'm looking at the belt of Orion. And I say, well, I am looking at the belt of Orion as well. And then you say, yeah, but the middle star in that belt is red. And I go, no, it's not. It's blue. Who is right? You or me? This isn't like the magic dress, which is black or white. Both of us could be right because we're using multiple projection systems. Now, we think we're looking at exactly the same belt of Orion because there is only one belt of Orion. What if there were multiple belts and you didn't know any different? Because remember, you can only be in one place at one time. And that's what we do with instancing. It's custom designed geographically for the user. So no matter where you go, you know, it's easy to do stuff in the sky. So because again, you can only be in one place at one time. Yeah, fine, you have a friend taking a picture at a different part of the world. That doesn't mean anything because the display system can display multiple identical images. That's the display system is easy. We can do this now. The harder stuff, the stuff you should be focusing on. I mean, everyone that asks that, it doesn't necessarily drive me crazy, but they're missing some of the bigger ones. It's like, how does a blood moon happen? Blood moon shouldn't even be possible because there should be, on a flat world, there should be no Earth between the sun and the moon. So how does a blood moon happen? How do crescent moons happen? Waxing, waning? How do you even get shadows on the moon if there is no Earth between the sun and the moon? That's the more basic question. Forget about the stars. And that's because everything is part of the display system. When you go to a planetarium, how do they display a crescent moon in the planetarium? It's not like you're shining stuff through other things and creating shadows. No, you're just displaying the moon with a crescent. No different here. By that I mean, when you walk out of a planetarium, like the Hayden Planetarium run by Neil deGrasse Tyson, when you walk out of there, who's to say you're just not walking into a much, much bigger one? And eventually you're going to come back and say, well, NASA and the rockets, and you know, they told us. It's like, yeah, well, you could have that much faith in the American military, but I don't. What was the other part of that question? I don't think that was it. Oh, so anyway, that's what I think it is. The harder stuff is on the ground. Don't sell the ground system short. A lot of work was put into those things, and by that I mean the jet stream, which is just above the surface, the underwater conveyor system, which runs all the currents in the oceans, the underground magma system, which controls all the volcanoes. All those are way, way harder to do than the display system up top. So just expand your mind. Open as I know it sounds like a religious cult when I say that. Expand your mind. Listen to the sound of my voice. Anyway.
Yes, I'm surprised you didn't bring up the whole, planetarium thought experiment. But
oh well, you know the argument there is because I've had if you were sober enough to remember. The guy from TFR that interviewed me that says I've looked at the moons of Jupiter through my telescope from my deck. I'm going, that's fantastic. You know, take a pair of binoculars, go into a planetarium and look at the moons in Jupiter. Do they look more or less spherical? And you say, well, it doesn't matter because I'm in a planetarium. It's like, well, who's to say you're still not in one? You know, that's the Truman Show argument. That's why I use the Truman Show as an argument. You know, the Truman Show is feasible. Engineering wise, it would cost a huge amount of money, but it is feasible. So, if you had an advanced technology and you say, well, no, it's too big. You can't build a planetarium that's thousands of miles wide. I'm going, well, unless that civilization is super, super good at what they do and had a long time to build it. I mean, who knows how old this place is? Anyway, next question.
All right. Now I'm satisfied. Thank you.
Oh, hey. Yeah.
Next one. The subject is thank you, smiley face. Hi, Mark. My name is Costa, short from Constantine, a Greek name. First, I would like to apologize. And second, I would like to thank you. The reason I'm apologizing is because when I heard of Flat Earth, I thought you guys were total retards. And the fact that anyone can put any type of crap on YouTube, I felt that even clicking on a title like that would insult my intelligence. But one day I decided to click on the title of Flat Earth, only because I knew that I could debunk it very easily. Out of all the clicks that I did with my mouse, this will be the only one that I will never forget. It almost felt as someone clapped their hands and I woke up from being hypnotized. I have read the Bible 3 times in English and 1 time in Greek, and after I discovered Flat Earth, boy, does it make sense to me. And here comes the part where I want to thank you. I am a born-again Christian years ago, and my blinders have come off. And I've seen the world the way it is. In other words, I have seen it in ways other people don't. And think there's nothing wrong with it. And then here comes Flat Earth. That's the icing on the cake for me. Man, talk about everything falling in place. So thank you for being courageous and fighting for the truth. It's so hard for me to share this, because obviously everybody will think I'm a lunatic for believing this theory. But from what I've noticed, 2017 might be the disclosure year. This has picked up so much momentum that I never thought it would happen this fast. Mark, thanks for being the ambassador on the subject. And now here comes the question. Obviously, we know our planet is flat. And of course, NASA knows our planet is flat. So my question is this. If NASA knew that a globe does not exist, how then did they come up with 1 mile is 8 inches squared? Keep up the great work you're doing, Costa.
Thank you, Costa, for all those kind things you said. And I don't know if I'm the ambassador, but I am a ambassador. And yeah, I've been interviewed a whole bunch of times. But I think that's mostly because I put my contact information out there and my real name, and I'm easy to get a hold of. So, and other people will come forward. Don't worry about that. As far as NASA creating the 8 inches per mile squared, they didn't. That was created a whole long time ago when they came up with the whole ball theory, which was once they came up with the radius. When you first say that, you know, it's 8,000 miles across, then it's 4,000 miles if you cut it in half. And 4,000 miles means if you divide that down all the way down to the mile, down to inches, then it's 8 inches per mile squared. So by that I mean, you know, it's 8 inches per mile times itself. So at 100 miles, it's 100 times 100 times 8 inches, which is about 6,700 feet. And if you keep going all the way out to about 4,000 miles, if you believe in the ball, then it goes completely over the side of the hill and goes vertical, and then you have to come back around the other side again. But no, NASA didn't invent that. Mainstream science did, and thank God they did, because that's what we use all the time. Because without that that inches per mile thing, we wouldn't be able to prove a lot of our points. So thank you, and hopefully you'll write some more questions soon.
Okay, just a few more. The next one. Hi there. I have an overall universe question regarding Earth. Do you think the passing of planet X or Nibiru over Earth or near Earth is still true, Anna Marie?
No, I don't. Nibiru, I used to be into Nibiru not a long time ago, but all the way back in 2009. And I even was one of those people that thought it might show up in 2011, you know, a whole year early. And then 2012 came, and then 13, 14, 15. I didn't even look last year. And every year I see videos and I just roll my eyes, because like, holy smokes, this thing is never coming. And now that I've gotten into Flat Earth, I've got a whole new take on it, which is I will definitely not be afraid of anything that shows up in the sky, especially if the mainstream covers it. Because if Nibiru does rear its ugly head up in the sky, you know, this red sun, this dark red sun with these planets and this big asteroid belt that's following it, if it does rear its head in the sky, then it's going to be staged. It's just going to be part of the show. And I don't believe it for a second. You know, what happened? You know, you say, oh no, it still could be real. It's like, really? What happened for the last 4 or 5 years? It doesn't take that long to orbit anything. And if you do believe in the globe model, what, there would be no vantage point. Nobody said, well, we saw it from Antarctica. Really? Or was it just a reinforcement tool, not just for Antarctica, but for the globe system? You got to remember that I fell for it. I did. You know, everybody's going to fall for something. And that is, every single interesting and somewhat mysterious thing that is you see in the mainstream news regarding space all has the same subtext. And by that I mean face on Mars. It doesn't matter if you believe in it or not, you're looking at it from a globe. Oh, a hexagon on the top of Saturn. Globe. Oh, our probe just went by Pluto. Globe. Nibiru. Even more so, because, you know, then you're talking about a whole solar system. And because the only pictures they ever release, you know, are from Antarctica, then you're reinforcing the globe and that Antarctica is a continent. That's the South Pole. It's brilliant. That part is brilliant. But it's wearing thin because they milked Nibiru in, you know, a long time. And it's not, I'm not buying it at all. And neither should you. So if you see something in the sky, yeah, it's going to look really scary and really noisy. Dude, it's probably not going to be an extinction level event because it's not there. It is just part of the display system, and it's going to be a very elaborate one if it shows up, although I don't know what's the point now. I mean, talk about a sequel that took way too long to make. So that's my take on it. So,
yeah. Next. Yeah, a lot of fake space news theories. Well, not even theories. Apparently fact, according to them. Yeah. Mostly by NASA for your entertainment.
It is mostly entertainment. It's as much as it's distractions more than anything. You think about space and you combine that with the all the movies, all the franchises, Star Trek, Star Wars, Battlestar Galactica, Stargate, those four franchises alone.
Which I love. Some of those series are awesome. But I was watching them before I looked into Flat Earth. So.
Oh, yeah. And I'll still watch them now for the plot lines, but I won't watch them for the space side of things. And you know, sometimes I'll even take a stretch and maybe imagine that there is a space somewhere, but not in the universe we're currently living in now.
Yeah, I've had to switch my mind that way too. And the most recent thing that has come up for me regarding like space news is this Earth from Mars picture, which I've seen. My the coworkers sitting next to me are just like drooling over these photos, and I don't even know what to say to them because it seems hopeless. But
yep. Yep, I totally agree.
At least I feel like, you know, at least I feel like I've cut through all of that BS.
Yep, hear you. All right, okay. What do we got? We got any more?
Yeah, just looks like two more left. Okay. Next one. Good morning, Mark. I was wondering what your take is on human origins. If you believe in Sumerian accounts, thank you for your time. Legend.
It's a great name. I don't think it's real, but that's fine. I do believe in the Sumerian accounts, and I do believe in previous civilizations. As a matter of fact, it kind of goes hand in hand. There are very few conspiracies that don't dovetail well into the enclosed world system. One of the only ones I can even think of is Richard Hoagland's people living on the moon and Mars, and millions of people living outside the solar system. But everything else I think fits. And I've said several times that we aren't the first civilization to rent this apartment, not by a long shot. Like anything, art imitates life and life imitates life. And there are previous versions of everything. We know this with software. You know, there's 1.0 and 2.0 and 3.0. And things get more elaborate and more complicated as you go up in versions. You know, was some of the early versions, did they have, if you look in the old legends, did they even have a sun and the moon? Or did the sky just lighten and darken like we did in some of our early simulations that we're doing now? You know, were the sun and the moon just added as decoration, and the stars? I think there's some wonderful passages that reference this. Were the continents lumped up in the center, a giant supercontinent called Pangaea? We're pretty sure that actually happened because you look at every kid knows that South America fits into the crevice of Africa really, really well. And the rest of it, I think, fits well, too. So when it comes to civilizations, that they're on par with the geographic changes as well. The The pyramids, how old are they? I've been to Cairo. I've stood in front of the pyramids. The Egyptians that are living there now, they had nothing to do with it. That place is the only true wonder of the world, and it was built by a very, very powerful civilization. Don't know who they are. Look at the sunken cities off of India, the sunken cities off of Japan, Atlantis, the Babylonians, the Sumerians. There's so many cool references out there and cool mysteries that we still haven't solved because the old versions have, most of them have been wiped clean. You know, yeah, everyone's heard in the conspiracy world of the Mahabharata and the Vimanas and all the tech that India used to have, but that tech is long gone, and we've got these big gaps in history, and I think those gaps are tied in with the rollovers from civilization to civilization. Who were version, if we're version 7, who was version 6 and 3 and 2? Who was version 1? Was version 1 the fallen? You know, if you go into the biblical stuff, were they the, you know, were, what version were the Anunnaki? We don't know. But I do believe in them. Yes, I do. Do I think the carbon dating system is off? Yes, I do. Do I believe in dinosaurs? Yeah, I do. But I don't think they're very old. I mean, I believe the Loch Ness Monster is probably a plesiosaur and swimming around. But you don't want to find that thing because then science, you talk about a question science doesn't want to answer. How is that thing still alive? There's been several fish discovered over the years and insects and other reptiles that defy... carbon dating, defy our knowledge of prehistoric animal life. And there's a lot of questions and a lot of inconsistencies, in my opinion, in mainstream science that I think the older civilizations could solve for us. So hopefully I didn't get too convoluted there, but I was starting to lose focus because I was staring at other things. Totally sober, mind you.
No, that was pretty coherent.
Oh, good.
I find it really interesting how ancient civilizations or beings might fit into our modern world, and you know how much of it is true, and maybe just our history is distorted just enough to make us think that you know, it's either not possible, like, you know, advanced technology and that kind of things. And
yeah,
I don't know, it's interesting food for thought.
Yep.
Okay, we have one last question.
Dun, dun, dun. Dun, 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 dun.
Does not the theory of a moving cosmos destroy the possibility of a moon landing, Scott?
Good question. That's a good one to end on. Scott, yes, you're absolutely right. And what he means by that is not that the Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour and not that the Earth is spinning around the sun at 60,000 miles an hour. It's that the solar system is screaming through the universe at 500,000 miles an hour. And you're thinking, okay, what's that got to do with the moon landing? If you believe in the solar system, then the moon and the Earth, because the moon is orbiting around the Earth and it's not plunging into our Earth, that means there's some sort of null point where there's a balance between in the gravity between the Earth and the moon, where you could seriously just sit there in orbit forever and not do anything. There's going to be, if you believe in the solar system model, there's going to be a little bit of gravity that's, you know, between those two bodies. But since the solar system is traveling at 500,000, it's an amazing amount of speed, 500,000 miles an hour, considering the fastest aircraft supposedly we've shot, it only goes about 20,000 miles an hour, not even 20,000 miles an hour. And this is exponentially bigger than that. Then when you send a rocket in there, it's sort of like you're trying to play tennis, like two trucks going down the road, and you're trying to play, throw tennis balls to each other. You know, the wind that's coming in there, and you say, well, there's no wind in space. There's a vacuum. It's going, okay, fine. Then use gravity as your excuse. Whatever it is, there is so much speed happening that your calculations for traveling from one body to another have to account for this speed, because if that gravity isn't pulling you along with it, it's going to leave you behind. And it's going to leave you behind really, really quickly. And that's what he's talking about. Now, do I think that's the case between the Earth and the Moon? You get a little wiggle room there because they're so close to each other. But it's got to be difficult. It's got to be way more difficult than they say. Anything outside of the Moon, impossible. No way. Because you're talking about free space where there's no gravity touching any. I mean, people say, oh, there's always going to be gravity. No, so little gravity that the speed would totally make that null and void. And by that, I mean traveling to Mars or Jupiter or Pluto. But the probes going to Pluto, not a chance. You know, any probes going to Mars? No. Supposedly, is something just landed on a moon near Saturn just today. No way. Not if the solar system is flying through space that quickly. How are you accounting for that speed? What sort of force is pulling you along? I am not buying it for 1 second. So good simple question, which is, how do vehicles travel from one body? Doesn't matter if there's people in them or not. How do vehicles travel from one body in our solar system to another one and counteracting that 500,000 a mile an hour speed of the solar system that's pulling everything along? You can't tell me that we are being, that all these little vehicles are being dragged along with it. There should be, you just can't tell me that. And science may say that, but I'm just not buying it. Anyway, that's the one I'm going to end on. So what'd you think? Think you want to do this again sometime?
Me? I'm just thankful that I am a part of this show after all the recklessness and abandonment that I, you know, have been accused of. So,
honestly.
I feel honored.
You know, sucking up to the boss, you know, it's not a bad idea. You know, kissing supervisor ass, it's not, could be worse.
Please, sir, may I have one more?
Yeah, don't worry. It's not that type of show. We're not supposed to. We're not supposed to do that. Anyway, thank you very much for helping me with this. And if people want to see a back and forth where the questions are being read to me by my lovely and sometimes irresponsible secretary, please, by all means, email me at msargent23@comcast.net. You can also leave the comments in this video if you want. I probably won't read them that much because I've got so many videos. I generally don't read comments as much as I read emails and listen to voicemails. You could also leave a voicemail at, we'll use the show line, 720-897-6111. And that show line is open even though there's not a show. You can always leave a voicemail on it. Any parting words, shots, shout outs, anything from you before we just call this one good?
No.
Seriously, how many have you had? Is there anything left?
I just need one more and I'm good.
Really? I think you're pretty good right now. That's all right. Anyway,
bye,
all right.
People.
Yep. Hey, see you guys next time. And don't forget to check out enclosedworld.com and Strange World on Truth Frequency Radio. See ya.